Welcome, 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 welcome. So glad to see you all on tonight. And we'll just give a few seconds here for everybody to get online. Again, I'm glad to see each of you. I see you coming in. I see you coming in. I see you coming in. Come on in. Come on in. Come on in. Amen. I see you there. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Glad to have you. Glad to have you. Got some great things to talk about and discuss tonight. Excited about our time together. So if you have not, hey there, Tanya Croon, I'm glad you're on. Good to see you, dear. If you know a friend of someone or someone that would benefit from our time together, hey, son, hey, Samuel Nickerson, glad to see you, son. If you have friends or someone that would benefit from our time together, please send them a text, a call. Let them know that we are on live now, and we're getting ready to start here. Hey, son. Hey, Ira. Good to see you, son. We're getting ready to start here in just a second, and we're using a new tool today, and so I'm excited. Samuel Nickerson, who gives oversight to our media ministry, has given us multi-streaming opportunities. So there's Facebook, Periscope, YouTube Live, and also Twitter. So we're on, and I'm excited to have each and every one of you on with us. Just a few more seconds, and we're going to get started. We're going to pray together, and then we're going to jump right in. So again, let people know that we're on, and we're going to jump right in. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for our time together. We thank you for all that will be said and all that will be shared. We thank you, Lord, for speaking to our hearts. We thank you for the change that will take place on tonight in our hearing, and as a result of what you've called us to do, as a result of who you've called us to be. Lord, as we incline our ear to hear your voice and to follow hard after your will and your purpose, we know that we'll be changed in your presence. So do it now, God, as only you can, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Hey, Tony Tazzle. Hey, Steve McNeil. I'm glad to see you all online. So listen, just real quick, I want to say a couple things to you. I want to share a couple things here real quick before we dive in. I want to say how important you all are to me, how just us being able to walk together, how it is a great benefit to me. I appreciate the fact that I have my brothers and my sisters walking life out with me. It's important to walk out life together. I want to say this to you, and I hope you all grab hold of this in the right way. I understand that my deliverance, my own deliverance, my own personal deliverance, is accomplished through walking life out with each of you. And so iron sharpens iron. There are some things that we certainly are delivered from, but as a result of walking together, as a result of doing that, there's some things that we certainly keep at bay as well. And so again, I'm so appreciative and so excited to have each of you all, and you mean a great deal to me. My desire in our time together is that you walk away as you leave our discussion, that you're a better man, you're a better woman, you're a better son, you're a better daughter, you're a better husband, you're a better wife, you're a better father, you're a better mother, you're a better brother, you're a better sister. And really so important is that you're a better Christian, that we come together to resolve our challenges, our issues, to hear the voice of the Lord for all of our lives. And as a result of that, we leave this place better than when we arrived. And so that's my heart's cry for you. I want to say to you all that I don't have all the answers. I don't want to presuppose that I'm perfect, because I am absolutely not. I have set my own challenges and my own struggles. I've needed and received my own deliverance. But it's been a process, and it's been a walk. And so I want to make sure that you understand from my perspective and for what I know, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't know where I would be. And so I'm sure that that's the same confession that some of you all have as well. But I am in no ways, do I have all the answers, but I can share with you. This is what I can share with you, is what has worked for me in following hard after God and crying out to the Father and repenting and changing my mind concerning some ways and some thoughts and some actions, that God has fixed me, that he has blessed me, that he has pulled me in close to him, and that he loves me. And if he does it for me, I can give you and say to you with a great deal of certainty, if he did it for me, that he'll also do it for you. So let's dive in, because I want to talk about a couple things. I want to talk about the fact that we're really good at fixing things. As men, especially, certainly some women as well, but as men especially, we're really good at fixing things. And, you know, we can fix stuff around the house. We can fix cars, problems at work, problems giving advice to friends, family, and loved ones. We give that advice, but we seldom take it for ourselves, but we certainly know how to give advice. Things require head knowledge. We are really good at things that require head knowledge. What we're not as good at, when I say we, I'm including myself, we're not as good at heart knowledge as we are as with head knowledge. And so I don't want to preach to you tonight, but I certainly want to share and discuss some things with you, again, that I think will be a great deal of benefit to you. So the first thing I want to share with you, and write this down if you're writing, write 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. I'm going to read it to you, and this is what it says. It says, if you confess, if we confess our sins, he, God, is faithful and just to forgive us of our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And so it's imperative to understand that, that if we confess it, that if we talk about it, if we're honest. And I think a lot of our challenge deals with the fact that we're not always honest with one another, and not even necessarily with one another as we should be. We're not honest with God. For some reason, we think and we believe that we can pull the wool over God's eyes, and he doesn't know exactly where we are and what we're struggling with and what we're dealing with and where we are and what we've done. And you see it played out in the Bible. You see God knows, and God, and yet we still try to deceive God. That's problematic and that's challenging, because herein lies our struggle. God wants to cover you. He wants to fix what's broken. He wants to make sure that we get into a place with him where we allow him to fix the broken things. It's interesting because in a very simplistic definition of what's broken and what broken means, it means that something designed to work a certain way is not working in that manner. In other words, God has designed you for a certain purpose and to operate and function in a certain way. He's given you ability. He's given you gifting. He's given you purpose. But when we are broken, we cannot fully function completely in the way in which we were intended to function and work in when we are broken. And the enemy comes in and things happen in our lives to cause us to be broken. But we have to acknowledge the fact that we are broken. We have to acknowledge the fact that we have issues and challenges that have to be addressed. Some things we came with, some things were passed down to us, some things we opened the door and allowed to come in. But it's so important that we understand, that you and I understand the importance of beginning to really deal with those things. And when God says, if you confess your sin, he says he's just and faithful to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. We have to understand that God wants to cover you. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to fix you. But God cannot fix what won't be honest. He can't fix a lie. And this is what I mean when I say that. If you're not truthful and honest, God can't cover you in a lie. He can't cover you in an untruth. The God that we serve, he's holy, and he has to be regarded as such. And so we can't come to him with the premise of being untruthful. We can't come to him with the premise of not being honest and open. That's the one thing I loved about David, because David was always honest and open with God. But David had struggled. If you look at Samuel, starting at starting at chapter 11 through chapter 12, I want you to look at that 2 Samuel, chapter 11 and 12. Read that and peruse that at your leisure when you have a chance. But I want to talk to you just a little bit about that, because David now finds this young lady. He sees her, and he wants her. That's the bottom line. We're going to be real simple in our discussion today. He desires her, sends for her, and he lays with her, and he shouldn't have, but he did. He did some stuff that he shouldn't have done, very much like you and I. We've done some things that we shouldn't have done and opened doors in our lives that should have never been opened. And it caused pain and hurt and some things that have happened to us as a result of those doors being opened, those doors that you and I opened ourselves. And so here we have David. David sleeps with the young lady. Then David sends for her husband. Her husband is out. He's a part of the army, and he's doing war. He's doing battle on David's behalf as the king. Sends for him. He comes back, and he tries to get the young man drunk and to send him home to sleep with his wife because he doesn't want to take the responsibility of having now the young woman is with child. And so he figures if he brings the young man home, he sleeps with his wife, he'll believe that the child is his. So here's the challenge. The young man won't do it. The young man said, I can't sleep with my wife and enjoy that pleasure with my wife. And knowing that my men are out at battle, that they're sleeping under trees and they're sleeping in tents and they're sleeping in the cold and they're hungry and they're fighting on our behalf. And I'm here experiencing this pleasure. And so he says, I'm not going to do it. And so David tries to get him drunk, sends him home, but yet and still he sleeps on the doorstep. He doesn't do it. So David then sends him back to the army, gives him a message and says to the captain of the army, send him to the hottest part of the battle and then withdraw the men. So he does that. The young man dies. And then after a period of mourning, David brings a young lady into his house, marries her to be his wife, and they have a son. What's interesting to me is when all this happens, that God says to him, if you read the text, God says to him in 2 Samuel 11:27, says, but this thing that David did displeased the Lord. And he was displeased at what he had done. And so David tries to go on with his life and, you know, acting like everything's fine, as you and I oftentimes do, even though we know we've done some things that we shouldn't have done. So David goes out and he's doing stuff and acting like everything's fine. And so God sends the word of the Lord by Nathan, the prophet. And he says to him, he says, I need to tell you something because there's two. And he gives him this story of sorts. He says, there's two men, one rich, one poor. They live in the same city. He says, however, the rich man has many flocks. The poor man has one sheep, one little lamb. And the rich man has a guest to come into town. And so the rich man takes the poor man's one little lamb, kills it to feed his guests. David is irate. He's upset. He's angry. And then what happens next, I'm sure David is not ready for or prepared for. Because Nathan says to David, you are the man. You are the man. You killed Uriah. And he says, and Nathan gives him this whole thing. You sent him to the battle. You killed him by the sword of Ammon's. And so he gives him this whole layout of what David did. And only God would have known and God could have known. And so he sent the prophet to tell him exactly what he did. And this is what David does. Hear me now. David says, I have done this thing. I have sinned and I have done this thing before the Lord. He takes full responsibility. And what was so interesting in all that, and I'm going to read it to you real quick. It says, Nathan said, you're the man. Therefore, the sword never leave your house because you have despised me. And this is what God is saying about David. You have despised me in your actions. However, he says, you did it secretly. He's talking to David. Nathan's still talking to David. You did it secretly, but I will do this thing before all Israel. So he's saying, what you did in private, I'm getting ready to expose you. I'm getting ready to put this thing out and everybody's going to see it and everybody's going to know it. God's desire is not to expose you, but he will expose you if you're not willing to be honest and truthful with him to deal with your challenges and your issues, the places where you are broken, the places where you have been hurt. But now you're hurting people. And so God will do and begin to expose a thing if you're not willing to be honest. Again, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he, God, is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God don't want to expose you, but he will expose you to cover you because he cannot cover you with a lie. And so then what takes place is Nathan begins to talk to him and tell him that what you did secretly, God says, I'll do this thing before all of Israel. And David says, I have sinned against the Lord. Nathan says, as soon as David admits his sin, because up to this point, David has not admitted his sin. When he slept with the young lady, when he sent Uriah to his death, he has not accepted or exposed or confessed his sin to God. In that moment, he says, and this is verse 13 in chapter 12 of 2 Samuel, he says, David says, I have sinned against the Lord. Immediately, Nathan the prophet says, the Lord also has put away your sins. You shall not die, but the child that you and the young lady have birthed together, that child will die. I want to say to you, there's some consequence to sin. I don't want you forever, any one moment, in any one time to believe and think that there is no consequence. That certainly God forgives you. He cleanses you from all unrighteousness. We move forward together with God. But understand this. And the Bible says it this way. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatever man soweth, that shall he also reap. So we have to understand there is consequences to sin. There's consequences in things. We pray and believe God that he cuts it at the root, and some things come back up and spring up against us. But there are some things that do. And we have to understand that there is consequence. But this is what I want you to get. Now, this is what I want you to understand. When as soon as David confessed his sin, Nathan comes back and says to him, the word of the Lord says to him that the Lord also has put away your sins. So I want you to understand the dynamic of that and the importance of understanding how God moves and operates in our life. I want you to understand that deliverance comes when you're honest. I want you to understand that in my walk with God and all the years that I've walked with him in some 25 plus years and walking with the Lord and loving the Lord and walking in ministry, in these much longer than 25 years, closer to 30 years, just walking in ministry, that I have had my own issues and my own challenges. And the thing that brought me to a place of deliverance was the fact that I could admit to God that I've got challenges, that I got struggles, God, that I can't fix what's broken in me. That until you fix it, God, it'll remain broken until I release it and give it to you. And that's the aspect of the part of our discussion that I really want you to get down in your heart. I want you to understand that in Psalm 51, when David begins to repent to God and he talks about the sin that he was conceived in, he talks about the challenges that he's had. He's talked about how he wants God to create in him a clean heart and restore into him a right spirit. I want you to understand that there's some acknowledgments, some things that we have to acknowledge where God is concerned, some things that we have to say, you know, God, I need you to fix some stuff that I can't fix. I need you to take away some things from me that I don't want to let go of. There's some things, and that's why addictions are called addictions, is because we can't let it go. We are addicted to it. There's something innate about us that wants to continue to do that. As bad as we know it is for us, as difficult as we know and challenging as we know it is in our lives, there's still something in us that we cannot simply let it go. And so we have to surrender some things to God. We have to say to God, God, I need some things fixed. Years ago, and I talk about this even in our ministry, in having challenges with integrity, you know, wanting my wife to have nice things and things that were, you know, of great blessing to her. Things, not that she even asked for things, not that she even wanted things, because I understand now what I did not understand then is it wasn't the stuff that was important to her. It was me. But I couldn't see past my own hurt, my own pain, and thought that the only way that she could really love me was that I gave her stuff. And that stuff, giving her stuff, put me in a place where I can't do both. I can't give her stuff and pay all the bills. And so I would struggle and I would be challenged in that. But the thing that broke in my life as she prayed for me and she cried out to the Father on my behalf. The thing that broke in my life is she said to me, I'll never forget it as long as I live. She said, if you never change, I'll love you. She says, if you never change, I'm going to always be here. I'm going to always love you. See, the thing for me and the challenge for me was I didn't think in and of myself I was good enough. I thought that I had to perform. I had to give her things. And she never asked for things. But I just felt that way because I was conditioned that way. I was conditioned in performing. And so with those type of struggles and those type of things, what broke it, first and foremost, my wife was praying fervently for me. And she said to me, and she made me understand and know that if you never change, that I love you, that my love is not conditional. My love is not based on performance. It's not based on you doing anything. I love you because I choose to. That was the first experience that I've ever had with agape love. Agape love is God's type of love, a love that says, no matter what, I love you. And when that happened, the thing in me that was broken, mended, and the stronghold that was in my life, that is the thing that broke. And it created in me the ability to walk in integrity and strength of character. And my wife and I have been married now for 28 years, going on 29 years. and it was the first 7 years of our marriage, and it was a challenge. It was a struggle. But I want you to know that when you're honest before God, because I had to get down and be in God's face. I had to sit. I had to lay down, prostrate before him. I had to cry out to him. And I want you to understand that God has delivered me. And the way that he delivered me, he'll deliver you. We may not struggle with the same issues. And what was my issue in times past may not be your issue. But we have all struggled and continue in some areas to struggle. And so what I want you to understand and what I want you to know is it starts here. It starts with you being honest before God, you confessing your sin, you confessing your struggle, your challenge, whatever it is. Some people have a hard time calling it a sin. You can call it what you want to call it. But the truth of it is, you know that there are some areas in your life that are broken. You know that those broken places have caused you to hurt other people. You know that if you could fix it, you would have fixed it by now. The truth is that you can't fix it yourself. You don't have enough strength, ability, or know-how to fix what's broken in you. The truth of it is, there's some things that's intended to bring you to the cross, to bring you to the feet of God, to cry out to him. And there's some things that happen in life. And it's not until we come to that place of breaking, that place where we say we're not going to hide anymore. We're going to be truthful and honest. And so it's so empowering to be honest. It's so empowering to be truthful, to where you can just simply tell the truth. Here's the thing about the truth. You don't have to remember the truth. The truth is always the same. You don't have to go back and say, your story changes. And then the person you're telling the story to says, well, last time you said this. And you're like, oh, yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, I forgot that part. No, the truth is, truth does not change. And you don't have to remember the truth. The truth is always the same. And so I just want to encourage you and admonish you along that wise, because God wants to fix the things that are broken in you. He wants to fix the things that are broken in you and help you and prepare you to go back and then fix the things that you have broken. One of the things in the reason why manhandle was birthed, I want you to understand this and hear this clearly. Manhandle was birthed out of confession of my brokenness, the confession of my challenge and my issues, confessing those things to God, giving them to him, and he began to restore and mend the broken places, and he began to do those things in my life that helped me get to a place of wholeness and health, not just physical health, but certainly mental health and emotional health. And then I could go back and then I could begin to repair the areas that I had broken. I would not be honest and truthful with you if I told you that I did not break some things in my wife in our first 7 years of marriage, and my behavior and doing things that were not integritous. But as I began to receive the Lord's healing, to receive all that God was doing in my life with regards to making me whole, I began to go back and I began to cry out to God, and I began to inquire of the Lord, how can I mend the areas and do things and make amends for the things that I've done in her life? And the Lord began to give me instruction step by step. He began to share with me and tell me as I began to pray for her and pray concerning her. And the Bible says, men dwell with your wives according to knowledge. Who knows more about your wife than God does? The one whom created her. And so he began to tell me things about her and things that she needed. And I began to address those things and speak to those things. I began to take responsibility for actions. We began to have discussions and dialogue, and she could ask me anything she wanted as long as she wanted to ask me. And as those things begin to happen in our lives, God began to mend the broken places, the places I had broken in her. God began to mend where trust was broken. God began to mend trust. And I'm sharing these things with you because I want you to understand that if God can do it for me, God can surely do it for you. I want you to understand the importance of allowing God to heal the broken places so you, in turn, can go back and fix what you've broken. We fix many things. But again, we have a head knowledge and not a heart knowledge. God wants you to have a heart knowledge. He wants your heart to be pliable in his hand. He wants you to understand how our actions, how it impacts and affects our families, our wives, our children, our brothers, our sisters, those around and about us. And God wants it to be such that as you lend those things to him, as you open the doors of your heart and you let him in the broken places, as he begins to fix those things one by one by one, he begins to fix those things. He begins to correct the areas, the wrong thinking, the wrong thought. When the way you see yourself as a man thinking, so is he. Some of us think about ourselves the wrong way. God's never intended for you to feel insignificant. He's never intended for you to have low self-esteem. But the challenge is when we think about ourselves and allow the enemy to come in, and we think about ourselves through those broken places, we find that we don't see our value. We don't see our worth. We don't think that we are worth saving. We don't think that we're worth the time spent for people to love us, and the fact that we can, in fact, be loved just like we are. I came to that understanding after the prayers of my wife and her confession that if I didn't change, if I never changed, that she would still love me. That let me know that God loved me. He loved me enough to send a woman who would love me through my pain, through my issues, through my brokenness. He allowed me to experience his love through her. And I'm saying that to you because I want you to understand that God wants that for you as well. He wants you to be whole. He wants you to be healed. He wants you to open up your heart and let him into those places that are broken. He wants to fix that. It starts with this: confessing your brokenness, your sin, your issue, your challenge, the point and place of deliverance, whatever it is. He needs you to open up your mouth and begin to confess those things to him. In response, the Bible says that he's faithful and he's just to cleanse you and to cleanse you. Understand the cleansing process. Understand what takes place. Understand that he wants to wash you with the water of the word. Understand that he wants to take the places that you and I look at, and we see the dirt and filth. We see the things that are wrong. We see and understand the things that we've done. But he says in his word that he wants to cleanse you. He wants to cleanse you. He wants not only forgive your sin, but cleanse you. And he wants to do those things in your life. He wants to do those things in your heart. He's a faithful God and he loves you. But it all starts with your ability to confess, your ability to acknowledge the broken places, your ability to say, this is where I need to be fixed. And I've tried and I've tried and I've tried to fix these things myself and I cannot. We acknowledge that. We acknowledge that in our weakness and strength is made perfect. We acknowledge that, God, I need your help and I can't do this on my own. I can't do it by myself. I say those things to you and I share my own experiences with you because I know, I want you to know there's help for you. And if God can do it for me, surely God can do it for you. Not only can he do it, he wants to do it. He wants to change you. He wants to fix you. He wants to use you for his purpose. He has a heart for you and he loves you. You are indeed the apple of his eye. So listen, I want to pray for you. I want to challenge you to spend time with God this week. I want to challenge you to open up your mouth and open up your heart to allow God access to those broken places. I want to challenge you to not be ashamed anymore. That's the thing that pulls us more than anything else to stay in our places of brokenness, is that we're ashamed, that we feel guilty, that we know we've done some things that aren't right. And the enemy would try to hold that over your head. But God says, if you confess your sin to him, that he will forgive you, that he'll cleanse you. He'll do those things because he loves you. He's a just God. He's a faithful God. And so I'm going to pray for you. And again, I just admonish you this week, I want you to begin to open up your mouth and I want you to begin to cry out to the Father and say, God, I need these areas in my life to be fixed. These areas that are broken. Some you may have broken. Some you may have given access to the enemy, but there's some that you came with it. The iniquity of the fathers visited upon the children. Some of that stuff you came with and it's not your fault. And you're not to be blamed, but you have to deal with it. I want you to open up your mouth and begin to confess that it stops here. The cycle stops here. The generational curses stop here. Those things that have held me back, they stop with me. They're not going to be passed on to my children or my children's children. It stops with me. And God, when he begins to heal those places of brokenness within you, he breaks the cycle. He breaks the cycle and is not no longer passed on to our children nor our children's children. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, I thank you for our time together. I thank you for my brother. I thank you for my sister. I thank you, God, for all those who are struggling with challenge and issue. Lord, I thank you that your word says if we confess our sins, Father, that you are faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God, I pray right now that you would just begin to move on their heart right now, that you would just begin to let them understand and know that you love them, that while we were yet sinners, we didn't have it all together. We didn't fix it. We hadn't even come to the place of accepting you yet. But while we were yet sinners, that you loved us and you sent your son to die for us. That's how much you love us, God, that when we're not all together, when we're not fixed, when we're not at a place where we feel good about ourselves and we do things, we're self-destructive in some ways. But Father, you love us anyway. You pursue us. You come after us. And so, Father, as we open our hearts wide to you tonight, we ask you, God, to come into our hearts. We ask you to fix the broken places. We confess those things, Father. We are open book tonight, and we confess the areas of hurt and pain and destruction in our lives. And God, we know that only you, your strength and your power, your love and your kindness, your grace and your mercy, only you can fix what's broken in each of us. So, Father, do it now for your glory. We love you. We adore you. We praise you. And we say that besides you, there is none other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I am believing God for your complete deliverance, for your wholeness. I'm believing God that what he restores, there is nothing lacking, and that he's going to do all that he's promised you in his word concerning you in your life. In Jesus' name. I love you. I look forward to seeing you this time next month, second Tuesday. Tell your friends. We got some things to discuss and some things to talk about. I look forward to seeing you soon. God bless you.